This month culminates in the celebration of Thanksgiving, a time that has been historically set aside to encourage people to think about all the good things they enjoy in their lives. And even though it seems like Thanksgiving is increasingly eclipsed by the consumerist holidays of Black Friday and Cyber Monday, it's still an important day in many people's lives. So we're taking advantage of that focus on Thanksgiving this month, using our Sundays to reflect on some of the reasons motivating our thankfulness. And we recognize that thankfulness is a key characteristic of God's people. We find Paul talking about this in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 18, where he writes that it's God's will that we give thanks in all circumstances. So we're thinking about some of the many reasons we have to be thankful. And this morning, we're going to take some time to explore our thankfulness by considering God's mercy. Before we do that, though, let's take a moment and pray together. Father, we are thankful. We recognize that you bless us, that you have blessed our communities and our country in more ways than we can recognize. We understand that there are responsibilities that come with those blessings, that while we enjoy them, we're to use them to further your will, to share the good things you've brought into our lives with the people around us. Help us to be generous, to be gracious and merciful to others like you have been to us. And we pray that our worship this morning will remind us about the ways in which your goodness has been a blessing to us, and that we'll find motivation to share that with the people around us. We ask this through Jesus. Amen. The book of Exodus begins by tracing God's rescue of the Israelites from their slavery in the land of Egypt and leading them through the wilderness to Mount Sinai. And then when he brought them to Mount Sinai, God entered into a special covenant relationship with the Israelites. It was a relationship that offered them blessings and privilege and protections. And very quickly, though, we find after the nation had received that covenant, after they had been benefiting from God's protection, from God's rescue, we find in Exodus 32 that they violated the terms of that covenant relationship. They made for themselves an idol and they worshiped that idol. And in Exodus 33, God announced that he was going to issue a severe punishment against the Israelites for their disobedience. And Moses mediated on the Israelites' behalf, petitioning God's mercy. And God conceded to Moses' mediation, and Moses asked for some sign from God indicating that he was going to remain in his relationship with the Israelites. And Moses asked if he could see God. God said, "You can't see me, but here's what I will do. I will let you see the trailing edge of my glory." And in Exodus 34, we read about that scene where God passes in front of Moses, and he doesn't simply pass in front of Moses. As he walks in front of Moses, God announces his identity, his character to Moses. And this is what God said about himself as he passed in front of Moses. Exodus 34, verse 6. The Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. These are the first characteristics that God said defined him. And notice the characteristic that he gives first place position. Above all the good characteristics that define God, God gives precedent to his mercy. He defines himself as a God who is first of all, merciful. And with that in mind, look in James. This was the passage that was just read for us a moment ago. At the other end of our Bible, James mentions the same thing God says himself at the beginning of the Bible. In James chapter 5, verse 11, James is discussing the various trials that were afflicting his audience. And he comments on the example of Job, who was also a person afflicted by trials. And he notes that Job's response to the trials cultivated faithfulness in Job. And as he's reflecting on Job, he said he saw in the story of Job the purpose of God. And notice what he says at the end of verse 11, James 5. The purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. When he says the Lord is compassionate and merciful, James is referring back to God's declaration of his character in Exodus 34. He's reflecting on what God said about himself at the beginning of the Bible and finding evidence in the various stories in the Bible, like the story of Job, that display the characteristics that God said define him. Now, it's important we think for a second about this mercy that defines God. By its very nature, God's mercy focuses on troubled people. If we didn't have troubles, we wouldn't need God's mercy. His mercy targets people who are mixed up with hardships and trials, whose choices have led to hurt in their life and the lives of people around them. And the fact that God defines himself as a God of mercy means that he is preferentially, the word I was going to use didn't come out of my mouth. It was a different word. You know, when you stand up here and talk, usually things go pretty smooth, but every now and then a word stumbles coming out of your mouth and it's a travesty. So he is preferentially, my mind has gone blank. Anyway, he likes to treat people who have trouble well. I will say it that way. And it's important we recognize that God's desire to treat well those who are in trouble means that we, with our troubles, are part of the group of people that God prefers to show his mercy to. Now, it's important we think about the motivation for God's mercy. In Exodus 34, in verse 6, when God describes his mercy, the word in Hebrew that's translated by our English word mercy is derived from a Hebrew noun that literally means womb. It's a word that carries with it a strong emotional component. God's mercy is not clinical. It's not merely judicial. It is an emotion that he feels deeply. It is a response driven by his love that he shows towards people who are caught up in a variety of troubles. Now, that has a little bit different connotation than mercy usually has in our culture. We tend to think of mercy as withholding punishment or harm from someone when it is in one's power to do so. And that doesn't necessarily speak to the same kind of motives that drive God's mercy. God's mercy is driven by love, not merely some utility or some judicial preference. Consider, for example, two passages that make a connection between God's mercy and that idea of the womb, this deep compassion that parents feel for their children. The first one is in Isaiah 49. In Isaiah 49, verse 15 and verse 16, Isaiah talks about how God will have compassion on his people in the same way a nursing mother has compassion on her child. And the word compassion that's used in that passage in Isaiah 49 translates the same Hebrew word translated as mercy in Exodus 34. God treats his people the same way a mother would treat her young child, with the same compassion, the same mercy, the same care. Another passage is Psalm 103. And turn over to the 103rd Psalm. Psalm 103 is a psalm written by David, in which he talks about God's mercy expressed through the forgiveness that he displays to people. And we're going to start reading in Psalm 103, verse 8. David wrote, "The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love." Now remember, he's quoting here from Exodus 34. Verse 5, verse 6, verse 7. It's a reflection on the identity of God that God announced in Exodus 34 as he revealed himself to Moses. And notice how David says these good characteristics of God manifest himself. Verse 9, "He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us." And this is why, notice next the motivation. "As a father shows compassion," that's the same word again translated as mercy back in Exodus 34. "As a father shows compassion or mercy to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him." God is motivated by a deep love for people, like the kind of love a parent has for a child. And these emotions that motivate God's mercy tie to his faithfulness, to his enduring character as he described it in Exodus 34, verse 6 and verse 7. It is loving faithfulness rather than some legal or utilitarian motive that drives God's mercy. And God's mercy expresses itself in very specific ways in the Bible. God's mercy displays itself by rescuing people from suffering and by extending forgiveness to them. And typically, forgiveness and rescue from suffering tie together. Consider one example. Go to the book of Micah. Micah is one of those little books tucked away at the end of the Old Testament. We call them the minor prophets because they tend to be fairly small books. And Micah begins in the first chapter by announcing God's judgment against Jerusalem and Samaria, the headquarters of the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Israel. He's announcing God's judgment against the Jewish people because of their idolatry, their unfaithfulness to him. And he outlines God's coming judgment throughout his book. But notice how Micah ends his message. Notice the last three verses in the book of Micah. Micah chapter 7. Verse 18, verse 19, and verse 20. This is how he concludes his message. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion, the same word, mercy, on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sin into the depths of the sea. You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham, as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old. God's love motivates his mercy, and his mercy seeks to relieve his people of their suffering. It seeks to forgive their sins, and it does all of that so that he can restore his relationship with them. I mean, there's another important element to God's mercy. God is merciful. He defines himself as a God defined by that characteristic. And his love for humans motivates his mercy. But there's another important element. God's mercy is characterized by an unreasonable generosity. In Ephesians chapter 1, Paul talks about this generosity. In Ephesians 1, verse 7 and verse 8, he talks about how God, according to the riches of his grace, lavishes forgiveness on us. He uses language, Paul does, uses language that emphasizes the overwhelming nature of God's mercy. It's not merely suited to our needs, it overwhelms our needs in a way that's equivalent to the riches of his grace. And it's important to remember that this lavish mercy that God shows to people, he shows to people who are not deserving of the mercy they receive. Think about Paul's discussion in Romans 3 through Romans 6 as he talks about the guilt of all people. He writes in Romans 3, 9 through 18, there is no one good, there is no one righteous, there's no one who does the things that God wants. All have sinned, all have fallen short, verse 23 of Romans 3. That's the state in which we all live. Yet because we live in that state of guilt, God overwhelmingly showers us with generosity, a generosity that we might look at as unreasonable in light of the identity of those who are the recipients of his mercy. Consider, for example, the story in the book of Judges. We want to look at three passages in Judges. So turn over to Judges chapter 2. There's a poignant narration of this unreasonable generosity that characterizes God's mercy in the book of Judges. The first passage is in Judges 2, beginning in verse 6. In Judges 2, beginning in verse 6 down through verse 10, we have a summary of the Israelites' time under Joshua's leadership. And if you remember, after Moses led the Israelites out of slavery in Egypt in the book of Exodus, he met with God at Mount Sinai. He received God's covenant that he then brought to the people. And Moses led the Israelites through the books of Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. And at the end of Deuteronomy, a transition takes place as Moses passes the responsibility of leadership to Joshua. And Joshua, we have an account of Joshua's time in this section in Judges 2. And listen to what's said about the period of leadership under Joshua and the elders who worked with him. Verse 7, Judges 2. The people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua. But then notice verse 10. When Joshua died, when the elders who worked with him died, and when that generation that lived under Joshua and the elders' leadership, another generation after them arose who did not know the Lord or the work that he'd done for Israel. A new generation of Israelites that didn't inherit that devotion to God that characterized Joshua. And notice, beginning in verse 11, the kinds of things that characterized that generation. Judges 2, verse 11. The people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. The Baals is a reference to the category of false gods worshipped by the Canaanites. They gave their allegiance to these false gods rather than the God who had rescued them, who had redeemed them, who had covenanted with them. Notice in verse 12, they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them and bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. And God's response to their flagrant unfaithfulness was to send foreign nations against them, to oppress them for the purpose of causing them to reflect on their choices and return to God. And when these nations would afflict them, the people would cry out to God. It says at the end of verse 15, they were in terrible distress. And then when they were in distress and crying out to God, verse 16, Judges 2, God would raise up judges who would rescue the people from those oppressing nations. But notice the response of the people in verse 17. They did not listen to their judges, for they whored after other gods and bowed down to them. And this is the cycle that plays out over and over again in the book of Judges. The people rebel against God. God oppresses them. They ask for his rescue, and he rescues them, and they refuse to listen to what he says. But notice in verse 18, the Lord was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted them and oppressed them. But whenever the judge who had rescued them, the judge that God raised up to bring relief to the oppression they were experiencing, when that judge died, they turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. They did not drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways. The portrait in Judges 2 is that this generation that arose after Joshua and after the elders who worked with him was a generation who in their heart refused to listen to God. They refused to do what was right. No matter how many times they benefited from God's mercy, they were unwilling to change. Now, skip ahead a few chapters. Go to Judges chapter 10. In Judges 10, we read about this cycle starting again. Judges 10, verse 6, we find the same language that we encounter in Judges 2, and this is often used in the book to indicate a new cycle of rebellion and oppression and rescue. Judges 10, verse 6, the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth, the gods of Syria, the gods of Sidon, the gods of Moab, the gods of the Ammonites, the gods of the Philistines, and they forsook the Lord and did not serve him. And here's what God's response was. Verse 7. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he sold them into the hands of the Philistines and into the hands of the Ammonites, and they crushed and oppressed the people of Israel for years. And under this oppression, the people cried out to God because they were severely distressed, as it mentions at the end of verse 9. And they cried out to God, saying in verse 10, we have sinned against you, we have forsaken you. Please relieve us of this oppression. Notice God's response. Verse 11, the Lord said to the people of Israel, did I not save you from the Egyptians and from the Amorites and from the Ammonites and from the Philistines? The Sidonians also and the Amalekites and the Maonites oppressed you, and you cried out to me, and I saved you out of their hand. Yet you have forsaken me and served other gods. Therefore I will save you no more. Go and cry out to the gods whom you have chosen. Let them save you in the time of your distress. It sounds like a harsh response, but one that we might say was justified in light of the pattern of persistent, hard-hearted rebellion that characterized the Israelites. But notice just a couple verses later, verse 16. I've been reading from the English Standard Version, but now I'm going to read from the New American Standard Version because I think they do a better job translating the Hebrew. Notice God's response. He could bear the misery of Israel no longer. This is God's mercy. His people were persistently, hard-heartedly rebellious. They refused to give up their evil ways, and God knew that. But when they were suffering because of their sins, and even though he knew they were unwilling to change, he couldn't bear their suffering. And so he raised up another judge to provide rescue for people who didn't deserve the mercy that he showed to them. That's the God that we encounter in the Bible. A God from Genesis to Revelation who's characterized by love-motivated mercy that is offered, that offers an unreasonably generous gift to people who just on the surface of things don't seem to deserve the mercy that he shows to them. And this mercy that God shows, that's motivated by his love, that's characterized by this generosity, seeks a very important goal that's crucial we recognize. God's mercy seeks to establish or restore his relationship with people. That is God's purpose. He wants to be in a relationship with each and every one of us, to be a blessing to us, to guide and protect us in our lives. And that's why we should be thankful for God's mercy. Now, we're going to think about some applications here. And while God freely showers his loving and generous mercy on us, and he does offer it freely. Paul talks about this, for example, in places like Romans 6, how it is a free gift from God to us. Even though he offers it to us freely, he does expect a response from us. But the response is not payment for the mercy that he shows us. He expects our gratitude, but the gratitude that God expects, the thankfulness that should be the response we offer to his mercy, expresses itself in a very specific way. The thankfulness that God expects primarily expresses itself through our practice of mercy towards other people. As we experience God's mercy, he expects us to orient ourselves towards others, to do to them the same kind of good things that God is doing for us. Consider, with that in mind, a few applications. God's compassion motivates him to comfort us. Paul talks about this comfort that he experienced in his own life in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, as he wrote about the various hardships that he encountered, mentioning particular instances where he was near death. And he says that he experienced God's comfort so that he may be able to comfort others. As we experience God's mercy, as it brings help and healing and comfort into our lives, God showers that gift on us so that we can then also extend comfort to others similarly to the ways that we have been comforted by God. The mercy that God shows to us through Jesus requires us to change our thinking. Paul talks about this in Colossians chapter 3, how we're to set our mind on things above where Jesus is seated at the right hand of God. As we come to understand God's identity through Jesus, as we recognize the opportunities that he provides to us through Jesus, it is to bring about a change in our thinking, a change that comes from our focus on Jesus. And that transformation is characterized by certain things. A little bit later in Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 and verse 13, he describes what that transformation looks like, how it's part of a new self that we intentionally put on. And listen to the characteristics that define this new self that comes about because of the transformation that takes place in our lives because of our experience of God's mercy. Colossians 3, beginning verse 12. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must forgive others. We are to demonstrate our appreciation to God by practicing forgiveness, merciful, generous forgiveness towards others in the same way that we have experienced God's forgiveness. That means then that there is an unreasonable generosity that should characterize our practice of mercy. We recognize from things, for example, like Paul writes in Romans 3, 9 through 18, we see in the list of passages from the Old Testament that he strings together to describe the sinfulness of all people, we see reflections of ourselves in what Paul writes. We recognize our own failures, our limitations, the struggles that define us. We know the ways in which we have been hurt by others and that we have hurt others. Nevertheless, God chooses to show mercy towards us. And he asks that we show mercy towards others. Consider, for example, in Matthew 18. In Matthew 18, beginning verse 21 down to the end of the chapter, Jesus has a conversation with his disciples about forgiveness. And Peter begins by asking Jesus, how many times should I forgive my brother who sins against me? And the implication is, how often should I show mercy to someone who's actively and in an ongoing way working against me? And Peter offers what would seem like on the surface a generous standard, 7 times. It's a good biblical number. Jesus' answer was not even close, 70 times 7. It's not a literal 490 limit. It's a way of showing there's no limit to the mercy and the forgiveness that you're to show towards others. And we recognize that can seem an unreasonable standard because it will put us in situations where we expose ourselves to hurt, to potential danger, and to hardship. Yet, that's the standard that God calls us to because it's one that reflects the way he has acted towards us. And our recognition of the ways in which we have been the beneficiaries of God's mercy should motivate us to practice the same unreasonable and generous mercy that God has shown us. And as with God's mercy, remember, we said that God's mercy seeks a relationship. His mercy seeks to put people in a place where they recognize his good character and are drawn into a relationship with him. As we practice mercy in our relationships with the people around us, we should practice it in ways that directs people's attention to God. Peter writes about this in 1 Peter 2, 9 down through verse 12, as he talks about how we, because of God's mercy, have been elevated into the position of his new priesthood in the world. And we're to operate in the world in ways that are marked by honorable conduct so that people, as they see our good deeds, glorify God. The way we behave, the way we treat others should direct people's attention to the God who shapes us, to the God who forms us, to the God whose mercy helps us become the people that we are. So that through us, people praise God and glorify him because of who God has made us through his Son. Our God is a good and merciful God. It defines him from the beginning to the end of the Bible. And because it's so central to his identity, it should be central to our identities. But we recognize that we're not as good and as merciful as God. We struggle in this area. But fortunately, because God is merciful, we have opportunities to constantly correct, to petition him for his ongoing forgiveness, to seek his guidance as we try to be the people that he wants us to be. And his mercy reaches out to us through the person of Jesus. It's in Jesus that we encounter forgiveness. It's in Jesus that we're given a new life, a new mind, a new purpose. For us, that relationship with God through Jesus begins at baptism, where we express our commitment to Jesus by reenacting his death, burial, and resurrection in baptism. It's a moment when our allegiance to Jesus allows us to be the recipients of that new life that God gives us, a life that takes on Jesus' identity as our new identity. But that doesn't solve every problem in our life. It requires a commitment to gradually working to correct our thinking and our behavior over time. This morning, if you need to petition God for his mercy, or if you need the help, the prayers, and the support of the church family here, whatever you need might be, you have a chance right now to come forward and let it be known as we stand and sing together.